This Week in Startups is brought to you by Wistia. Create your free Wistia account today and get started hosting your videos in just minutes at wistia.com/twist. And IBM. IBM's dedication to the startup community is exemplified in the 10 startups that will be attending Launch Festival April 6th and 7th in San Francisco as VIP guests from around the world.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to This Week in Startups. I'm your host, Jason Calacanis, and this is the show where we talk about technology, startups, trying to change the world by investing in, building, reporting on all of these amazing companies that are changing our lives. With me today, two friends of the show who've been on many times. Liz Gaines is with us. You know her because she was at GigaOM, our friend O'Malik's old company. Rest in peace. And then she was at DN Recode. And now, you did some sort of fellowship, right?
Mm-hmm.
It was at Stanford?
Yeah, last year.
Amazing. What fellowship did you do?
The Knight Fellowship.
Oh, the Knight Fellowship.
Mm-hmm.
That is wildly prestigious. I forgot that it was a Knight Fellowship. That's huge.
Thanks. It was a fun year.
And they just basically give you money for a year to pursue something.
To like work on your brain, go to classes.
My God.
It was a wonderful year. And actually, the coolest part of it, perhaps, is that there's 20 people in it, and they're from all over the world doing different types of journalism, and
they all
bring their families, and you have this cohort of like super cool people.
What was the most interesting thing somebody else was doing?
There's a guy from Kiev who literally fished documents out of the reflecting pool of the presidential mansion as the guy was fleeing the country and ironed them out with like hair dryers and stuff and uncovered all this corruption.
Wow.
Yeah. And I like write about tech startups.
Right. This guy's got like a hair dryer and like diving in the pool.
Yeah, actually like all the young journalists in the country got together and did it together so like one of them wouldn't get singled out as the person who did it.
Right.
And they shared the information together.
And put in a gulag. Yeah, and then meanwhile.
I mean, not that Ukraine has gotten that much better since then, but.
Right, no, but I mean, Julian Assange is like hiding out and he's like getting everybody else to flip documents and he never takes any responsibility for anything.
Yeah, he's at the embassy.
He's at the embassy hiding.
Still at the embassy, yeah.
Yeah, well.
Anyways, yeah, I did that. And then I just started.
You started something new,
yeah.
Which I was just hearing about, the 60 dB. I'm going to go ahead and say dB stands for decibel.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, we're a short form audio app. Yeah, that's right. So it's not just stuff I'm making, but also all sorts of other things. Not. Your stuff is in there. We don't feature the long stuff quite as much. But actually, because I was coming on today, we put your show right up top.
Cool.
But it's like Netflix meets NPR. And those are where our founders are from, Netflix and NPR.
Very cool. And so is the idea being like Swell, where you would flip through?
Yeah.
And kinda...
You know what? I was a big Swell user. And
I was like an investor.
I think it's the closest thing since Swell.
Yeah.
But similar to Netflix, where you kind of realize that like having original content matters. We are doing that starting early on. And also like we live in kind of this voice era now. So like this morning I was listening on Alexa in my house and then I got in the car and like I was already halfway through a story and it just kept playing in the car. So it's all
so
like
genius.
A little bit more connected than Swell got to me.
Yeah, I'm loving, I love Swell and I'm very disappointed that they sold. Even though we got a little bit of a return, but it was very cool how it would start to understand what you listen to and present that more.
Yeah.
And discovery is the big problem in audio writing. So many podcasts.
It's personalized and we take into account, you know, similar like the swiping and favoriting of things, but we also try to burst your filter bubble a little bit too.
Sure.
So sending in things that you might not have heard of. We try to be personalized, but also open-minded.
It's interesting. What I do is I try to find topics that I don't normally listen to. And so I went on a whole thing because I was like, you know what? I should listen to some more diverse podcasts. So I was listening to Baratunde had a very good podcast called Our National Discussion about the Discussion on Race.
Mm-hmm.
And then two African-American journalists had Still Processing at the New York Times.
Yeah, that's a great show.
Which is fantastic because I didn't know about Atlanta. I had heard about Moonlight, but didn't, and they wouldn't shut up about Atlanta and Moonlight. And then I saw both of those, and I was like, hey, these are two really amazing suggestions that were kind of, they basically were the tipping point for me to listen to those. And I think that's where podcasts can be really good, so I think it's a very good idea.
There's a ton of stuff out there, but maybe you want to be suggested into new things.
I love the Richard Simmons podcast. If you're not listening to the Richard Simmons podcast.
Is there a new episode yet? I think it's tomorrow.
Episode 3 is up.
But 4?
Oh, 4 I don't know about. No, 4 is not up yet, unless you pay. But I don't care about it that much to pay. I'm kind of busy. All right, listen. Also with us, so everybody check out 60db.co, 60db.co. And Ben Parr is with us. Everybody knows he was the editor-in-chief of Mashable. Now one of the Gawker editors is the editor-in-chief, right?
Is the executive editor.
Executive editor. What's her name?
I can't remember.
Jessica Cohen.
Cohen, yes.
I've never met her. She seems lovely, and it seems like she's putting some like editorial focus at Mashable, which I think is a good thing.
I just started listening. Speaking of podcasts, Peter Kafka has an amazing podcast at Recode.
That's why I knew the answer to that question.
Right, because I just listened to the first third of her interview.
Yeah.
And it's a fascinating story. Jessica Cohen was working as an assistant in Hollywood, I think an executive assistant or something like that. And she was writing snarky comments on blogs as like a pastime. And I guess, you know, Denton did what we did at Engadget, which was let the inmates run the asylum. We'd hire the commenters to write the blog posts if they were good. But she came out of nowhere. This is what Denton was very good at. He would find talented writers who were naive and didn't care about burning bridges. And then he would put them in a position and say, hey, burn all these bridges. You don't know these rich people. They don't care about you. It's powerful people. And she went crazy, like burning bridges. And I think, was she the one who got just barbecued by Jimmy Kimmel on Nightline or something?
No, that was someone else,
Who was that? But anyways, trying to defend Gawker Stalker, where it's like, this is kind of dangerous. Like, the title of it is Stalker. Like, not a joke if you've been stalked. But it's very interesting. That whole class of Gawker writers.
I feel like that's kind of when the stakes of the internet were lower.
Yeah.
Like, she can still come back and have another version.
She can have an executive editor job at Mashable.
Right, yeah. You know, if you make a mistake or you're naive and you do stupid stuff because Denton pushes you towards it, like, you can actually recover from that. But today, you wouldn't be able to recover.
I mean, how often?
I don't know. It's harder. Just like, today, it's like a death threat, not like a Gawker Stalker, you know? Like, acting out on the internet is more serious.
I just got a kind of semi-death threat. Not a death threat, but like, kind of like a semi-death threat. Like, I was like, really, I have to call the police? Honestly, like, this is ridiculous. The world is very angry right now.
Yeah.
I'm not worried about it. I put myself out there. If anybody wants to jump the fence, I got a Ruger. I'll shoot him in the face.
You have a sniper on the roof?
No, I have a Ruger, which is like an old school revolver that will put a hole in you the size of like a grapefruit. Like, do not jump the fence at Jason Calacanis' house. Let's just leave it at that.
Okay, I hope you leave that warning.
Just like, no, honestly, you know where I got that tip from? Somebody was stalking my dear friend Shenny, and she's not a pro-gun person, but she posted pictures of herself at the gun range getting trained with her gun. Stalking stopped. She documented all this, like, but literally, like, you'll see Shenny Jardin shooting guns, and you're like, why is Shenny shooting guns? It's like, she had a stalker. She went to the shooting range. Stalker's not so interested in messing with her anymore. And Ben has a new company. Trying to segue out of guns and death threats.
I do have a segue. We actually hired a former Gawker reporter, Paul Booten, as our
reporter. Paul's a good friend of mine.
So Octane AI also owns Chatbots Magazine, which is the largest publication in bots.
Wait, who owns that?
We do, my company.
Oh, good.
And so, like, you know, it's over a quarter million readers per month, and Paul is our senior reporter. He's writing about the bot industry.
Amazing.
Where
Paul
does he
is
live?
Very talented.
He lives in Palm Springs.
Okay.
We're an entirely remote team, so everyone,
you
can live anywhere.
Yeah, I thought he was, like,
in the Northeast or something. Paul worked on Engadget and Launch for a little bit.
Yeah.
Very talented writer. Good friend. To give it my best. And so Octane AI, what is that? That's your startup?
Mm-hmm.
What does it do? You're not saying yet, is that
No, right? No, no, it's public. We launched the company in November, initially as like the easiest way to create a bot on Messenger, because there's a billion people in Messenger.
Facebook Messenger we're referring to.
Yes. And that's the size of Snapchat plus Twitter plus Instagram combined. And so every business will at some point have to figure out a strategy for this social app that has a billion people on it.
Yeah.
It's just the same way you have a website, you will have a bot at some point. Our approach is different, though, where there's a lot of companies that are like, we can help you build a bot that you'll only use once, which, you know, in some cases is great, or you want a really custom experience, that's great. We don't do that. We're more like a medium for bots might be a better way to think about it. And so what we focus on is making it a really good content experience. So you can create these things called convos. They're the equivalent of a blog post in Messenger, and you can share them just like a blog post. And so rather than sending people to your blog, you're sending people to your bot where they can have this scripted conversation that you create.
So is it like an FAQ on your own speed?
You can do anything. You could do FAQs. So like there's chefs who are making recipes, like how to teach them. You could do like a blog post style where you could have a commentary. You could do educational stuff. Like it's the same thing as what could you write as a blog post? And the answer is anything.
So you have call and response basically. So you could say, hey, would you like to make salmon? pasta or whatever, and the person says, I want to make pasta, and okay, what kind of pasta do you have? And then it says, I have spaghetti. It says, okay, would you like to make spaghetti with these three dishes and go back and forth kind of thing?
In a lot of ways, yes. And most of the time there's like buttons where you will be able to like, you can script the flow that the user will go through. Mm-hmm. And we make it super easy to create this stuff. We created an editor that's kind of like Medium where you can write this just like you would write a blog post.
Hmm.
Super easy to create this, super easy to share this. Because we think that right now part of the problem with bots is that there's a lot of good things about bots, but there's also, you know, there's some justifiable criticism. A lot of people think of bot discovery as this like app stores, that there should be an app store to discover bots. We think of more like YouTube accounts where you don't discover a YouTuber through a YouTube app store. You discover them by finding, like, stumbling upon their piece of content they made, a video. And then you're like, that's interesting. And then you learn more about that person, and that's why you subscribe. Same thing. If you create great content, you can now go viral through Messenger with Octane AI. And there could be like...
What's the viral component? Because my thought was when you talk to a bot, you're just talking to a singular bot. How does it go viral from there?
So you can share a specific... Like you could create a convo. Let's say we create a convo about today's episode.
Right.
You could share a convo and talk about some of the highlights, and there'll be share options. And you can either... as a user, share that with any of your friends on Messenger, or you can get a link. And you could, like, just like you could do with a blog post, copy and paste it, put it on your Facebook page, and people can go to it.
So I could say, here are the 10 like clips from the news program, and say, you know, here we're talking about Snap, or here we're talking about Uber, and then you could say,
you
share.
Like, choose your own adventure.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Oh, yep, you could choose your own adventure, or go down the single line. Maroon 5 and Aerosmith, Jason Derulo, a whole bunch of artists use us. So like Maroon 5 used us to exclusively release a preview of their new song, Cold. And when they did that, they actually went viral with it. It went, and the size of their bot's distribution doubled. Hmm. To be clear, their bot is nowhere near as big as their 39 million fans on Facebook. But the bot
What's the biggest bot? Who's got the biggest bot out there, like in terms of engagement and in terms of just number of people using it, right? So which one do people use for an extended period of time and often? And then which one just has the raw largest number of people?
The answer is I don't know. And
yeah.
The only people who probably know is Facebook.
Yeah, I wonder if...
You know, you asked me earlier if I had a bot, and I was... No. Kind of like, I can't think of it. But you know what I have used is the Duolingo bot. Mm-hmm. Is really good.
Is there a Duolingo bot?
Yeah, like...
Oh, that is a good one.
It's awesome. So I've been trying to polish up my Spanish after learning it last taking
bueno.
In college. And like the main Duolingo interface is basically like flashcards, and it's kind of fine, but it's like doesn't actually help you speak.
Right.
But the bot interface is great because it's freeform, and like, you know, you can say, let's plan a vacation, or let's order at a restaurant, or let's like get dressed or whatever.
That.
It's actually really good.
Yeah, I'm getting really into this like educational stuff. I started playing with brilliant.org, which I'm an investor in, and like it's like I really want to like get my statistics and probability and math stuff just up, because like I'm 46 now, I can't remember half the math theories because it's 25 years ago that I learned them in college or whatever. And just like, wow, you can just go somewhere and just catch up, right? Or learn a language for free or for 10
and
bucks
a month.
It's
kind of like having a private tutor, you know, to have a bot quiz you and like talk to you.
It's kind of Star Trek-y, like, you know, like they put those kids, like the Vulcan kids, in this little like learning cube, and they're like, just go learn and talk to your avatar and it will teach you. All right, listen, we've got a jam-packed show, and I'm going to just give you a preview of what we're going to talk about, and then we'll talk about it. But obviously Snap, the big news this week is Snap goes public, and the company became worth $35 billion, but it's come right back down. They raised $3 billion. And
that's
people,
true. I think it's down at like 21 or something.
21, yeah. So they had a really big jump up. But I think the big question is, where does it go from here? What's the long-term future of it? Obviously, Trump is claiming that Obama wiretapped him. And I'm only laughing because it's unprecedented. And if that's true, Obama, I guess, is going to jail. I don't know. I don't know how he got that in there. Palantir is perhaps going to be the deportation machine for Trump's new improved and refined deportation bill and process. Also, some discussion of Twitter, and Uber's been in the news of late, and not for great reasons. Bitcoin has hit a huge milestone, and Google got some huge milestones going on. All that and more coming up. Hey, everybody, let me tell you about an amazing product and service I use. It's called Wistia. Video is super important. You're watching this video right now. And we do lots of video for our incubator. This is one of my great secrets. We record every incubator session. Why? Well, because recording video is not expensive anymore. We have all the equipment anyway. Then we put it behind a password-protected firewall and an intranet. Then the people who are on the incubator can go in and watch the videos and study them. Now, here's where it gets interesting. We have an audit trail. We know when each of the people in the incubator have watched their video, and we require that they watch the video, and we can actually see that they've watched it once, twice, or three times, and we can post comments on the video. So I will go in and annotate a video for one of the companies and say, hey, at this point in your presentation, you notice you didn't have numbers to back up your claim. You might want to add a number or a chart at this point. Hey, this part of the presentation, you were telling us about your product, but you weren't showing us the product. Why don't you do a little product demo here? And I can put those very specific notes in to the video. This is a video created for under 30 or 40 people, but it's incredibly effective. Video is one of those tools that people in business don't think about that often, but that is super powerful. And I know you're probably thinking about it because you need a solution that is not messy and janky, and where the platform is trying to get more people to watch ads. You want a clean, crisp version of your video for your website, and that's what you use Wistia for. It is industrial strength video for business. Who else uses Wistia? MailChimp, Moz, HubSpot, Zendesk, Herman Miller, Sam Adams, and they have grown to over 330 user accounts. When they started as a partner on This Week in Startups 2 years ago, they only had 50,000. And they give you, again, amazing analytics like we talked about. They let you capture emails. So now we have, I think, 80 or 90,000 emails on our email list. And every week we get a couple of hundred more. And that adds up over time. And when you create a very deep relationship with people, and it doesn't have to be forced. You can just say, hey, would you like to get information on the next episode or come to a live This Week in Startups? Give us your email. And you could have a skip button there. Or you could require the email for people to watch your video. It's up to you. You have the power with Wistia. It integrates with 20 email and marketing automation tools, and you can share your videos with everyone on your list. Tons of resources to help you get off the ground, like what microphones to use and putting video and email together and building a lighting setup for $100. Their blog is amazing at Wistia. And you can create a free Wistia account today and start hosting your videos in minutes. Just go to wistia.com/twist. Wistia.com/twist. I love this company. It's awesome. We use it ourselves. Okay. Snapchat obviously has raised $3 billion. The company has faced stiff competition from Facebook, which not only has copied ephemeral messaging, messages that disappear and that don't have a trace. I think they did that first with Poke, and then they added that to WhatsApp. They also copied pixel by pixel stories in Instagram, and growth slowed at Snapchat going into this IPO. That was pretty scary for people. Despite all that, the stock traded at the IPO happened at the high end of the range. I think it was $17, shot up to $27. At the time of this taping, it's $20 and change, and it's lost a bunch of value, but it's still a $21 billion market cap company, bigger than Twitter, with much less revenue. Liz, what are your thoughts about Snapchat? Is it massively overvalued, appropriately valued? And what are they going to do with $3 billion and this huge market cap?
Well, I think that it, so first of all, I do have a personal conflict with Facebook because my husband works there.
Okay.
But I say that to excuse my free thinking, not to say that I actually am conflicted.
Yes.
I think it's really valuable that there's a real competitor to Facebook, and it's sure. A creative, interesting company that comes up with new stuff. And I think of the things Facebook has copied, stories just seems like, it's just like newsfeed. That's a way people
yep.
communicate. It's a part of every app. And it makes sense that it does well within Instagram too. I think Snapchat is a difficult company in part because it's all kind of like resting on this creative genius of Evan Spiegel. And I haven't written as much about them recently, but I wrote about them a ton when they were just starting and got to know him pretty well. And he's a really impressive guy and a good learner and comes up with things and likes to think differently. But like, you know, just as we saw at Uber this past couple weeks, like having that kind of cult of personality around a founder is pretty risky.
It's a double-edged sword.
Yeah. And I think that like that is going to snap back on Snapchat.
Oh, you do?
At some point. Or snap.
How does a company mitigate against that sort of cult of personality that Steve Jobs or Travis or...
They build a team.
Right.
And Snapchat, or Snap, does not have that.
Snap doesn't have that.
He
team
is
yet.
The guy. I mean, they hired a number two at one point, Emily White. She yeah. left. You know, they've never really brought someone in who ever gets to speak about the company. I think he's the only guy who goes on the record.
Yeah.
I mean, it seems like it's like a one-man show in a way that's pretty scary. But I do think he has good ideas that are worth keeping around, and I don't want the world to just be a Facebook world.
For sure. Ben, we saw four very specific, unique features in the past 5 years since Snapchat came out: ephemeral messages, stories, the lenses, AR, and now spectacles. Which one of those do you think is the most important going forward?
Of the four, I mean, the core is still the ephemeral messaging and the ephemeral photos. That's the core of Snap, and that's the core of like stories as an example on Instagram. And the big thing, like I was having this discussion yesterday, the spectacles are not supposed to be like a giant product line that makes millions of dollars. They end up driving just more minutes that are created on Snapchat. If you're going to use the spectacles, and I have them somewhere in my bag, it's just going to have more time on the app, which means more advertising revenue. The same kind of model that Facebook and Google do. The more time you spend on their apps or on their websites, the more money they make. And any tools, whether that's like an Android or spectacles or whatever, helps drive that process.
Did you buy this sort of IPO roadshow video when they're like, we're a photo company and we're a photography company and we're just so pleased?
I think if they say that, then the comparison is GoPro, which has been like a wild investment, right? Like,
yeah.
If you're like, we're a camera company, okay, well, how do camera companies do?
Kodak and yeah. It was a very weird position statement. I didn't understand that. I thought
they were just trying to position really hard against maybe
being Twitter.
Being Twitter, yes. But they probably positioned maybe too hard because they're not going to be a hardcore hardware company. At least they probably shouldn't be. They're a software company that focuses around photography.
What are they, now that they have this $3 billion in cash and they have a currency to buy other companies, do we see them going on in a massive M&A sort of process in order to sort of fill in this valuation, which is incredibly high? Is there stuff for them to buy?
Yeah, I can't think of what it would be. I think they have done a lot of little deals, especially around
Bitmoji.
This kind of AR stuff.
Well, spectacles was
that was the biggest deal, probably.
Yeah,
right?
Probably.
Which one?
Bitmoji.
Yeah, and those were, what does Bitmoji explain?
It's
you make
like
an avatar of yourself,
right?
And then, I don't know, sorry.
Yeah, no, it's pretty much that. You make an avatar of yourself.
And but they're not using it for anything yet.
Oh, it's in the app.
It is? What do you do with it? You make
cool avatars and cool like things and expressions of yourself.
Like instead of me sending you an emoji of like a yellow circle laughing, I send you an emoji that looks like me laughing.
It's the customized like stickers and emojis and such.
Okay. And so what do we think is the future of Snapchat? You guys seem very down on Snapchat. Like
the future is make more is increase revenue and increase user growth. Because if their next quarter does not have a decentish jump on that user growth, the story of Facebook is eating their lunch will cement. But if they have the next quarter really matters. If the next quarter they have a good a good percentage growth rate, then the idea will be like, you know, they're going to be fine. They're going to be like the counterweight to a Facebook. But if they don't have the growth, that's the problem. That's why the stock is falling right now, because that growth rate is low. And they're scared that like Facebook is going to eat their lunch.
But you spent time in LA, right? I mean, they're an LA company, and like studios come out with a new picture next year. So they're going to keep doing that kind of thing, right? It's not, it's a movable target. They will have multiple hits.
I think that although obviously the IPO got ahead of itself, I don't think anybody would disagree. I don't think people inside the company would say they're worth what their valuation became in these early days.
They had really, really good market timing.
Right. The timing is amazing because nobody's gone public in a long time and everybody, let's look at Facebook's
run-up. And the market's just hot.
The market is incredibly hot since, you know, Trump solved our employment issues and everybody's back to work. You know, all those millions
all
of jobs.
All those trade deals have been renegotiated.
I mean, those trade deals
I mean, the regulations are just falling off.
It's amazing. I mean, you can
now. The taxes are probably going away. So.
We're not
going
to pay taxes. You can dump pollutants in the water. We're going to save the coal mines. Everybody's got a job. What
so
could be better?
So that's good for Snapchat, right?
I can't hear my Trumpacopter.
We're going to get to Trump in a second as we segue. But let me wrap up the Snap with my position after I got my guests' lukewarm positions on Snap. I think it got ahead of itself. clearly. I think it's a $10 to $15 billion value company. Like, if it was $10 billion, I'd buy the stock. If it was $15 billion, I'd be like, I could sit and wait. And here's my theory of why.
That's not that different from what it is.
Half. It's like $10 billion less than it is now and $17 billion less than it was a day ago.
Versus a Facebook.
Right. And so if it was a $10 billion company, I think, wow, this person came up with four very unique ideas. Zuckerberg and his team, the gang of three, Instagram, WhatsApp, and Facebook, all tried to kill them, tried to buy them, and then tried to kill them over and over again. And they can't kill them. And they keep coming up with great ideas, which means there is something there. So yes, you may have a God-King issue in that, hey, there's one person who's reigning supreme there, and what happens to him if he goes away? But the converse of that is he might come up with 20 new ideas given all this money and resources. So Evan Spiegel might become incredibly dangerous with additional money. He might go buy a camera company. Who knows what he's capable? He could go buy GoPro. He could go do all kinds of interesting things. That's a pretty good idea now that I think about it. And he has no fear, I don't think. He is now going to be dangerous. The company is not going out of business, that's for sure. And he's got control of the company. So I think that there is a thesis to say this could go 10x from here. In which case, if you could lose half your money, like there's got to be a floor for Snapchat to get bought by another company, right? So if Facebook offered $3 billion for it X number of years ago, they would offer $7 billion now, or some other person would offer $10 billion, right? So if you say the floor is, just say the floor is $8 billion. So you could lose half your money if you bought in at a $16 billion valuation. If you lose half your money, but you have the chance to make 10X, that's a pretty good bet. Like in poker or any other game, of chance, you'd say that's a pretty good bet. That's why people are buying the stock. If the person has made this much progress and they have more resources, that looks interesting. And if the big competitor can't kill them, that looks interesting. And if it's priced reasonable, maybe you take a little risk because there is some downside protection.
I want to make a proposal for a sushi bet.
Okay, here we go.
Sushi bet, right? Let's write down the number that we think Snapchat's market cap will be exactly 1 year from now.
All right.
This is the part of
the show
tech
where you,
that I don't care about. Right. I don't.
How about this? I don't invest
in these companies because I write about them.
All right. Yes. Let's do something other than market cap.
All right.
Let's do the number of users, percentage growth in users.
That's an interesting one.
In 2 years.
2 years.
Gotta make it a little. 18 months. 18 months.
Maybe 18 months.
Hopefully,
too short.
The fish is fresh, right?
Well, no. Can we buy the fish when the bet matures, okay. Not now.
What's the exact number right now? It's 100 something, 60 something.
Emmy Award-winning producer Jackie will get us the number. So it's very simple. 18 months from now.
Sushi bet.
18 months from now, we're going to do a three-way sushi bet capped at $100 a person. All right? Whoever wins, and it's a round robin. So whoever wins, you're going to either beat both people, one person, or lose to both.
And it's
right?
Price is Right rules?
No. You don't get to do one extra point. So it's just whoever's closest.
Closest.
Right,
okay.
But you're making a bet versus me, and you're making a bet versus Ben.
Okay.
So it's independent sushi bets.
So we'll be at the bar.
Capped at 100.
Okay.
So, but if I go, I order Otoro, which is $12 a piece. So it's going to, I'll get it to go, too. I'll bring it home to my daughter. Anyway, and I'm going to win.
What are we starting number?
18 months from now, how much bigger will it be? I'm doing my math. Can I get a little do-do-do music? Do-do-do-do. Thank you for that. Do-do-do-do. Do, 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 do. 6 quarters from now, how much will it be worth? I am doing some simple math right now. Do, do, do.
We're doing the user, not the worth, right?
What's the current number?
I believe it's 160 or 160 something. I'm finding the exact number.
All right. We need that number. Who's got that number? Snap has 158 million daily active users, says
great.
Austin. Thank you.
Oh, that's daily active.
Let's go with daily. We'll go with Dow.
All right, 158 daily active.
Okay, so where would Dow's be? 158 right now. What will the number be? Do I have my percentage? Not doing my percentage. Times that is plus that amount, which puts it at exactly 2, and then carry the 1. Okay. I have my approximate number, which will be, okay, I have my number. You have your number, you gotta hold it up. Here we go, I'm gonna hold my number up.
All right, I will make it bigger.
Okay, here we go.
Oh, sorry, I'm
18 months from now, the number of daily active users will be, write your number, I have mine written. Anyway, try it anywhere. I just want to make sure you're not cheating and changing your number at the last minute, because you know it's really not about you. It's about Ben, because he would cheat.
Sure.
3, 2, go.
200.
I put 221.
I put the lowest, 182.
Okay, now this is a great bet.
Excellent.
We have a range of 40 million. I put it at 221. You put it at 180. So just very small growth. 182. And you put it at 200.
200.
So you're saying
for reference,
18 months from now.
I just interviewed Will Remus from Slate this morning. In this article he just wrote about Twitter, he said in December 2012, Dick Costolo said Twitter would hit 400 million monthly active users within a year. Instead, the company filed to go public in late 2013 with only 218 million monthly active users. More than 3 years later, the active user number is still just 319.
319, yeah. And since Jack took over in the 6 months, I mean, talk about catching the knife. The company was going up, 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 and then all of a sudden it's like, oh, there's a plateau. And then it just plateaus for six straight quarters.
Yeah.
And you could put an arrow at the start of the plateau. With Jack's avatar on it. I mean, it's not fair.
His Bitmoji.
Put his Bitmoji right up there, and it's literally Jack equals plateau.
Yeah.
It really is bad optics.
Well, which is to say that things just don't just go up, right?
Like, but here's why
we are
all win.
Somewhat optimistic.
Let me explain why I'm going to win. It's very simple. What you didn't take into account was that they could buy a company that has more daily active users. So I think the daily active users is going to go up because they're going to buy their way to it. That's my belief.
I didn't put a lot of thought into my bet, I'll give you that, but that's fine. I put more thought, I'd know that we'd be better.
But I think you might win.
I do think that
it's reasonable
to put into context that their users are primarily young people in the U.S., and there are a lot of other categories of people.
Correct. There's old people. There's
people in China.
There's people in China. Jaina. It's pronounced Jaina.
I knew that was coming.
You knew it was coming. Okay, let me take a pause for the cause here and thank my friends at IBM. They are dedicated to supporting startups and developers. I know this because they host our incubator at their amazing office on Market Street. And they love to build developer communities in cities around the world. They provide support, connections, and opportunities for growth. And they help thousands of developers build cognitive solutions with Watson. Yes, you know Watson, the computer that beat everybody at chess. Well, they've been doing AI and machine learning for a long time. A lot of my startups use Watson, and it works across every industry. And, you know, IBM gives free credits and support for 1 year to startups. They're incredibly supportive. They want to see little companies get big. And IBM is the largest supporter of my launch festival. Thank you so much. They have a lounge at the event. You can come and meet the team and get those Watson credits. IBM is dedicated to the startup community, and that's exemplified by the fact that they bring 10 startups to the launch festival every year as VIP guests. They give them those really good VIP tickets, and they give them demo pit tables. We do a lunch with me and other investors, and three of them will pitch on stage at the IBM Smart Camp competition, and one of those winners will get an investment from me of $25,000. What? I'm giving $25,000 to the winner? Yes, I am. And they'll come to my incubator, and they'll spend 12 weeks with me and my team refining their amazing products. I really have to say thank you so much to my friends at IBM. You've been incredibly supportive of the startup community. All right, let's get into Trump. And then we'll go on to Uber and Twitter. what a trio. Here we go.
Are you just putting off the Uber conversation?
Yeah, just a little bit. I'm just going based on the order it was given to me.
Okay.
Trump, Twitter, Uber. We could skip. But let's just go through Trump real quick.
What's on Trump?
You can never go through Trump real quick.
Well, we have to just go quick. And I just want to let people know, this is not a political show. If I want to do a political show, I do one. This is a tech show. So we're going to talk about Trump through the lens of technology, and since he only communicates through Twitter, I think that makes everything fair game, but let's talk a little bit about H-1B visas. It used to be 15 days to expedite these. Now it's going to go to months. He has specifically said during the campaign trail, hey, H-1B visas are abused, and they're keeping Americans from getting work in IT and other places, and that companies use them as a way to have indentured servitude. He didn't say this, I'm saying this now, but that, essentially extrapolating his thoughts, there is a belief that these are used to create indentured servitude amongst people who want to come to the United States, pay them less, and if your H-1B visa goes, everybody knows you have 30 days to get out of the country or get another sponsor for your job. Is Trump in any way right about H-1B visas needing to be reformed?
So, just to clear up, has he said something official on this, or are you going still based on campaign stuff?
U.S. immigration, customs, H-1B visas, suspension. This is an actual story in Recode. And I don't know if this is a proposal.
No, so let me. Let me break it down a little bit, because I've been doing a lot in.
And I'm going to open that
area.
Story. I'm sorry.
So what? It's not a proposal. It's going to happen.
Yeah.
And so what basically is in the HBV? There's apply.
April starts.
Right, and then you can it takes a month to get through the process. But originally there was a way where if you paid about $1,250, you could bump up the line and get a 15-day. Expedited review, which the big tech companies, $1,000 is nothing. So yeah. Pay and expedite people. The expedition process will no longer happen for the next 6 months at the very minimum. And the reason that the administration and the office is saying is because there's such a backlog of HB1s that they want to actually focus on getting through the backlog some rather than just going through only the expedited with limited resources, which, on the surface does sound like it sort of makes sense. And Trump's discussion of does HB1 need reforms? Yes. Yes, it does. All of immigration needs reforms, but that's the most hot potato of political issues. It absolutely needs updates and reforms, but it is also absolutely one of the ways in which you bring people. One of the downsides of this is that if you if you want to switch jobs, you need to go through that HB1 process again.
And you can't expedite now.
And you cannot expedite now.
So family has to get ripped out of San Jose or Cupertino or San Francisco, wherever they are.
Or more indentured servitude. You're at Microsoft and you have an HB1 and you get an offer from Google. You can't switch after 15 days because
you have to go to Canada and hang out in Toronto like a criminal.
For 9 months, or you just can't at all.
And what happens to your kids who are in school? This is where it's really infuriating for me.
This is an interesting announcement, but the larger question is what actually happens to these skilled worker visas at all,
right?
So this is just you can't pay $1,000
to get special
processing.
This is how he starts. This is Trump's process, right? He starts with some low hanging fruit. Sometimes he goes all the way, but it seems like now the administration is going to chip away, right? This is something we can change.
Doesn't H-1B go on a lottery system in April every year? So if it's almost April, so this year may be approximately normal,
right.
And then we'll see next year.
Right. Yeah. This is, I think, every conversation I've ever had with a founder or a technology person about H-1B visas, and this is where Trump, I try to be bipartisan, but I also try to be rational. He does have a point. When he says they are abused. Because I can tell you as an investor in technology, every time this conversation comes up, the starting point is, how much will it save us? How much are we gonna save?
Because you can pay people less.
Versus an American.
Yeah.
So if his position is, they're doing this to pay less than American workers demand for the same job, he's 100% correct. I hate to be the person in tech who actually agrees with Trump on something, but that is the truth.
No, I think that, and there's other parts of it too, which is that there's 65,000 of these things that go out to companies,
right.
And a lot of them are taken by folks who are doing call center type jobs,
right?
Temp jobs, IT department jobs.
It's IT stuff mainly, and the other thing is, I think it's completely inhumane, the process, because companies are this person's going to have to do whatever we want because if not, they get kicked out of the country. So you immediately go into employment. In an indentured servitude situation where if you are going to do anything for your employer, it doesn't matter, work nights, weekends, whatever it is, you do not want to lose that status and get kicked out of the country.
Yeah, I think that's a nice thing for you to say, but this is a repeal and replace kind of situation.
Yeah.
So what is the alternative?
Right, yeah.
And we don't know. We haven't heard anything about that.
Right, yeah. It's the ability to communicate. I think one of the biggest problems people have with this presidency is the communication methods. You want to have a more communicative president, but you would like to have the communication be substantive and intelligent, and the discourse has not been that way.
That is very political and proper way to say it.
Well, MayorJason.com, you notice the suit. I'm getting ready to take on Kara Swisher in the mayoral election.
Nice. 2019
is going to be a hell of a year.
I want to go to the debates.
Oh, it's going
to
be a hell of a year. As I told everybody, we'll be in the debates, and I'll just say, listen, if you want San Francisco to be New York, pick me.
I want
to
moderate one of those debates.
Half like New York, and half like San Francisco with Kara Swisher. She'll be like 60% San Francisco, 40% New York. I'll be like 60% New York, 40% San Francisco.
Who's got the Ron Conway block?
It doesn't actually matter. I think whichever one of us win, San Francisco wins. That's my position. I got nothing to say bad about Kara Swisher. I think actually I could help her get elected. People look at me as a possible option. They'd be like, this person seems much better.
I know where you're going with that.
I'm the Manchurian candidate in all of this. They're going to clip this during my campaign. I'm the Manchurian candidate.
Good slogan.
I'm the Manchurian
candidate. All right, we're going to send this out to Kara.
Exactly. What's the story with Palantir and their involvement? Because now we know Thiel said, don't take Trump literally. That's the problem. But Trump has literally been pretty aggressive on immigration with people who...
was wrong about that. Palantir, under contract with the Obama administration, has built the databases that tie together all the information that the government has on everybody. And that's about to be fully up and running by September, according to the very little that we know about it. And that would be used to do things like when you are driving behind a car, look up its license plate and instantly know what the immigration status is of the person who's driving it and pull them over. So kind of like getting all this information instantaneously at your fingertips in that very Silicon Valley way, in a way that could be used to deport people.
Wow. Yeah.
And possibly already is. But we just like really, like the only thing we know on this is like the receipt trail of the government contract.
Right.
So we don't actually know what it fully does.
This Skynet is real and it's at Palantir apparently.
Well, you know, this is the thing. You know, Obama was very hawkish on spying on people. And now it creates this narrative when Trump takes over that, Obama was much worse than me in terms of he didn't shut down Guantanamo. And he was trying to get more rights to, you know, wiretap journalists and other people. It just plays into whatever narrative this administration wants to start their surveillance state with.
Yeah, I mean, we'll see what comes on encryption and other things like that, too. I mean,
there's going to be a big one. Do you think that they'll try to ban encryption in the United States? Is that possible?
They're trying to ban it in the White House. They're trying to ban, like, Signal and those and Confide and other apps. They like did a phone check with like a bunch of White House staffers where they had them to put their phone out and like, look, do you have Confide or do you have any one of these like encryption texting apps? Because that's how the leaks are happening. So they're already doing it.
Well, it's a slightly different question.
Right.
Yeah. What do we think about the wiretapping claim? I don't know what the tech angle here is, but Trump claimed on Saturday that Obama wiretapped him. Is that possibly true?
The trail that journalists seem to have figured out is that he probably got the idea from a Breitbart article.
Sure, yeah.
Instead of like, you know, he has access.
The FBI, the DOJ.
He could just like, show me papers. It's not effing true. It's not even close to factually true.
You know what's fun about being on a show with Ben is you ask an impossible question like right. that, and he jumps right in. I don't have to say anything.
Yeah, exactly. He's like, here it is.
Can you verify whether a FISA court wiretapped?
Here's why I'm saying this, because no one would even entertain that possibility because it's ridiculous, except now we have a president that puts things like this and we have to say, maybe it's possible. And it's almost certainly not, except in the like very 0.001% that the moon landing was actually faked kind of thing. No.
Let me segue this, because I think his use of Twitter is the kind of interesting keystone here. Ellen Pao, of the famous Kleiner Perkins sexual harassment lawsuit, which, Liz, you covered.
Yes.
You were there.
I was.
She lost.
Mm-hmm.
And had to pay legal fees, or was...
That's true.
Which is a really severe loss. You would agree?
Yeah, she lost.
But she lost more than just loss. She had to pay the legal fees, which is an additional admonishment, I think.
Yeah, but she also...
But they settled.
Yeah, and... She went to trial. She aired her grievances pretty effectively.
Right. She wrote a piece. She's working for KPOR Capital now with Mitch and Freda, friends of ours in the show. She wrote a piece that they should delete Trump's account. And I thought this is the stupidest thing I've ever read. Like, if you're going to delete the president's account.
Yeah, that's a pretty fast path to irrelevancy for Twitter. Like, this is, Trump is the best thing that's ever happened.
Right. So on a business case for Twitter, this is like, he is the number one user on the platform right now. Number two, you can't ban the president from a communication platform. He's the president of the United States. It's completely illogical.
Yeah, I mean, it shows, though, how hypocritical their enforcement policies are, for sure.
Sure. Right. If he says, like, this person's a fat pig or this, that's harassment. They don't allow harassment. So they are in a, like, hey, this person said, if this unknown person says someone's a fat pig and you ban them, you know, it's good enough to ban Milo, then why isn't it good enough to ban the president? So, yeah, that's a perfectly logical point. But you can't ban the president. Then number three, if you're anti-Trump, which I am, and I think probably everybody in this room is, and probably everybody within a 300 miles of San Francisco is, he is going to tweet himself out of the presidency. Like, this kind of insane tweeting without vetting.
Oh, you just want to let it go.
You want him tweeting. It's the worst strategic idea ever to stop him from tweeting, because he gets up at 5 o'clock, he tweets, and nobody knows what he's going to say. And this, to me, it seems like Saturday was this kind of tipping point where now the FBI is like, hey, no, we have to get involved in your tweets now. And he is going to hang himself with these tweets.
Apparently, people have noticed that the pattern is, like, that's when his daughter and son-in-law are not around because they're Jewish and observe the Sabbath. It's like Saturday morning is when the crazy comes out.
Right.
It's like no one's babysitting him.
Fascinating. And they said the logic, they also said there's another theory. The Android tweets,
yes,
which might be related, are the crazy tweets.
Absolutely. Yes.
And the desktop tweets or the Windows tweets or whatever, there's some other
normal
are the ones that are, like, are dictated or spoken.
I can't believe the Android story. I know that that's an old story, but it's just amazing that he's apparently using a unupdated 2012 Samsung Galaxy phone that he's, like, somehow made slightly more secure by the fact that, like, he gets texts and he doesn't call people back from that phone.
Oh, like, I saw that story.
Like, I don't know. That story is amazing.
Everything is in play nowadays. We live in an alternate reality. And
it,
you know,
does feel like a simulation now. I mean, after what happened at the Oscars and then Trump, it just feels like whoever wrote the code of this simulation is really, like, either a bad coder or they have a very sadistic, strange sense of humor.
Where is the out valve so you can go to the other simulation?
I would literally like to reboot the simulation. Can we switch accounts or something? There's got to be a mod.
We got to make like a Stargate. Stargate.
All right, listen, here we go. Let's talk about Twitter, the topic everyone wants to talk about. Okay. From Liz, video evidence prompts Uber CEO to say he must grow up.
Yes, one of the few stories about Uber.
It is a cluster of stories in a short period of time. I would say they had a year when things seemed to quiet down and they seemed to be making great progress on the public image. You would agree with that? Or some progress?
There was some progress, but that doesn't matter anymore.
Right. Because it seems like after the Emil problems, where he said some things about journalists, who shall remain nameless, they seem to have a pretty good focus and were doing some good things. But now we have this video that came out, sadly, of Travis getting into it with a driver. What did you guys think of, candidly, the exchange? Obviously, Travis said he's ashamed and he's got to do better as a leader. How bad was that video in your minds?
I think it was part of the pile. I mean, to be honest, like, the things that he said, the tone that he took was bad, but he was responding to someone who was kind of picking a fight with him.
Yep.
So
it takes two to tango in that case.
You know, it's just interesting to see what would be a private video in any other circumstances,
sure,
be deemed newsworthy and get to our eyes. I mean,
yeah.
But I don't think that people are necessarily surprised by that behavior. It was more that it validated the disdain that people assumed Travis Kalanick had for drivers.
And what were your thoughts?
Well, it was a perfectly timed video in terms of when it was released, and it's part of that narrative. It would be a different narrative if it had just been released on its own maybe 6 months ago, and we would have a different discussion around it.
Sure.
Like, the whole point in the end is, like, a CEO of a major multi-billion dollar corporation, no matter what, can't act like that. You can't be goaded into that because it's a trap. And he fell for the trap, and that trap was recorded. And now he's realizing, like, you can't fall for those kinds of traps, and you can't do those kinds of things. And even if that's part of his personality, I don't know enough to say, like he's an aggressive person, but I don't think he's, like, a horrible human being by any sense
No.
Yeah. But you can't fall for those sorts of things, which is why, like, whatever leadership training he's actually talking about is good, and then the story and the information about him finding a number two is also a very good thing.
That's been updated since we've been talking, actually, that Uber just put out a statement saying, this morning I told the Uber team that we're actively looking for a chief operating officer, a peer who can partner with me to write the next chapter in our journey.
Yeah, peer is the key word in that sentence.
I read that whole statement. In our journey.
In our journey.
Yeah. Well, I mean, in fairness, I was talking to a friend about this last night, and we were talking about Facebook's journey and Mark Zuckerberg's journey. He had a pile of lawsuits and a bunch of problems, as we remember. But it didn't seem as compressed, my friend was telling me. Like, if you just think about this, all happened, and like it seemed like the same 3-day period or week. So you have this, you know, all condensed into 1 week. And then, yeah, Sheryl had a really amazing transformative effect, I think, on that organization and setting tone.
But here's the difference. Like, I mean, I want to hear your opinion more than I want to hear mine on this. But
everybody wants me to talk about
this. Uber is an invisible company. They're a logistics engine for all these physical objects in the world.
Yeah.
Therefore, brand is hugely important. Facebook is actually a product, right? Mm-hmm. So, like, Facebook needs to have people who go to work and do their job and don't get fired every day, which I think is what, like, before Sheryl Sandberg came in, they had a huge turnover problem.
Sure. Yeah.
But Uber needs people to like it because someone else could do the same thing.
Yeah. I was on CNBC, and I'll make a couple of disclaimers here for the audience. Obviously, people know I'm an early investor in the company, and I've been friends with Travis for over 15 years. I knew him from his first company, Scour. I knew him at Red Swoosh, and we've been personal friends, like, you know, have dinner together, friends, like on a somewhat regular basis, you know, or just hang out and, you know, have a drink or something. So we're personal friends, and I'm an investor. So I am the most, you know, conflicted, biased person in the world, but I also have unique insights into it. What I would say is, you know, this company has had to fight for its very existence since the beginning. And as I said to some other investors early on, I don't think that there's a CEO who could have, I don't think Uber could have been successful without Travis as CEO. Because you would have to have somebody willing to wake up in the morning and deal with all kinds of corruption at a city level, you know, at a company level, from people trying to stop them from launching these products in different markets, right? And we've all kind of forgotten. They just had to fight. Like, now you take an Uber in Las Vegas, and it's like, oh yeah, of course you can take Uber in Las Vegas. That took 6 or 7 years of fighting. And they had to do that in every market. And I think that fighter mentality is what got them here. And as I've said to Travis himself and other people, in life, what gets you here is not the same skill set that gets you there. In other words, what you need to do in the early stages of a company is not what you need to do in the later stages of a company. And if you look at Steve Jobs and the way he had to operate in the early days of Apple, you know, he had to go off on his journey and then come back. And he was a more refined and deft person when he came back, a better leader. And I know Travis, I know he is not a bad person. I know he cares deeply. But I do think he needs help. I do think he needs to have a team around him of people who can mentor him. Yeah. And the team that's gotten them here is an amazing team. Like, when you just think about what they've created, it's just phenomenal. I invested in 150 companies. And when you look at this outlier, it's truly amazing.
Do you think someone at Uber needs to take the fall for what's happened?
You know, this is a very... I don't. I think if anybody does, well, there's two different categories here. If somebody does something like harass a person, I have a zero strikes, you're out. Like, zero strikes, like one strike, you're out. And I think that's why you probably saw some people leave recently very quickly, because I think that zero strikes is in effect, or one strike and you're out is in effect. I don't know that, but I assume that's what's happening when we see two quick departures like that, the Google executive and the former Facebook executive, both who had claims at their previous companies, this company, whatever, you know, they're done. And we just have to have, all companies have to have zero tolerance about that stuff. You can't make exceptions for people because they're a high performer. You have to have a, you know, one strike and you're out. So those people, yes. For the people who are running the company, I think it would be a shame to remove people who have gotten the company here. It would be unfair to all those other people at the company who are working so hard, unless somebody was specifically doing something, you know, which this investigation that they're doing will show, right? Eric Holder's in there, Arianna Huffington's in there, Bill Gurley's in there. They're going to know from this investigation if there's some bad people who have done bad things. And whenever, I can tell you just human nature-wise, whenever you put 10,000 or 20,000 people in any behavioral situation, there will be some outliers of bad behavior. And you have, it's not that bad behavior occurs in any of these companies, because it happens at Facebook, Google, every company. Twitter has had many sexual harassment cases, obviously, that have come out very publicly. When those things happen, it's how you respond to them. And how they responded to this last one was not acceptable. And my tweet at 2 hours after it happened was...
Which one are you talking about?
Susan's situation. I think that's the only one that is actually confirmed.
The blog post about...
Abusive work culture. Which we none of us know the details of, but I will take it on faith that they're true. I always assume that the person is not lying when they make a claim like that, because there is such a huge cost to making a claim like that that I don't see people typically making that. It does happen, but I don't think it's a very rare occurrence that it happens. So I believe her without having any inside knowledge. I give her the benefit of the doubt. But I said after that, I just don't, this is not acceptable. The management has to fix it. And so that's the way I look at it. But people also assume that investors have a bigger say than they do. I don't, people assume I could walk into the Uber offices, my name's at the front desk, it is not. I can't come to a board meeting. I don't get to vote on anything. You know, I don't sign any paperwork saying this is the new policy. But I can say publicly that this stuff is not acceptable, and I can work behind the scenes, which is what I choose to do. I choose to work behind the scenes, talk to the people involved, and say, hey, here are some ideas of how we might be able to work on this. Do you want to talk about any of these? I am available.
Have you talked to them in the last couple of weeks?
Yes, you can assume I've talked to them frequently. Anytime there is a major situation that occurs, I will be talking to them. Absolutely, 100%. Now, if it's something minor, like somebody has a dispute over you could actually check my Twitter. I've had people who've had disputes over a charge from Twitter include me in the tweet, because I'm one of the high-profile investors like Saka. So when anything goes wrong with this company, Saka and I are CC'd, and that's fine. Bill Gurley gets CC'd as well. And I've said, hey, here's the support number. Like, so I will actually direct them to support. I don't think that's too much to ask of an angel. I disagree with Freda and
oh, really?
Mitch, because I do think that while you can state your displeasure, but I believe in a more collaborative approach to solving this and a more quiet approach.
Because so publicly calling out the company as an investor,
I think,
is not okay.
No, myself, Chris, and the Kapoor.
So what did they do that crossed the line?
I think writing very long blog posts and going out on a press tour and doing a Vanity Fair interview like came out today, I think it's a little bit too much. It's sort of like, hey, let's put the attention over here on Kapoor Capital, and we want to... Some people would think it's virtue signaling, like we're going to come out really strong and we're going to attack the company. I don't think they're virtue signaling at Kapoor Capital, but it looks like grandstanding to me from the outside. And I don't think that's productive, because now every time there's a problem, they're going to expect us as the investors who don't have power to write 10 anti-Uber blog posts or anti-Google or anti-Facebook. And that's not actually working on solving the problem.
What about, I have to...
That's my belief.
What about Saka's Twitter post when he wrote that long Twitter post about...
Yeah, I don't agree with Chris on that either.
Okay.
And I told him that.
So when you don't have as much influence as when there are 10,000 employees, but you probably have a fair amount of influence when they're smaller. So what are you going to do in the future to ensure that this kind of situation does not emerge
at
your next
question.
Angel company that becomes an Uber?
I have... a very detailed discussion with people, and I have had for many years, about these issues and what my expectation is of them. And it includes things like take the work seriously. And take the work seriously can be unpacked to, you know, any of these type of shenanigans I don't want to be involved in. So, you know, people fraternizing inside of companies, I think, especially for the leaders, is a big no-no. I know that many people in our generation met their spouses at work, so some incredible numbers, like very high numbers about that. While that's true, and that was okay for a different generation, there's a group of people who seem to think that they can, the company is their dating pool. I am infuriated by this concept.
The reality is that our work lives and our personal lives are so merged now, right? Like, you're on Slack in bed.
Agree, but I still don't think you should date at work. I think it's unprofessional.
Okay, so that's something you should take a public stand on then, because that's
I have taken a public stand on. I've said it many times. I think people who date at work, I mean, listen, I understand people can fall in love.
Because that's when you set the cultures, the companies that you're involved with early on. When it's less than 10 people, when there's no HR person, that's when you set the culture.
Of course, yes. And I talk to people about setting culture. And if you don't set a culture, in our incubator just last week, the topic was culture and setting a culture. And we had 15.5 come in, which is another investment of mine, which asks people to every week give a review of their job and what's going well at the company and what's not. If you can imagine a weekly cycle of everybody having a voice, think about what that software can do for a company that has troubles with culture. If everybody has a weekly 15-minute report they fill out where they can either anonymously...
That sounds like a lot of
work. It's 15 minutes. So 15 minutes out of your 40 hours a week, yes, it is 160th, but it's less than 1% of your time, but it's a time to reflect on what you did that week and what you think is good or bad with the company. That's 15.5.com, 15, the number 5.com. And the only reason I bring this up is I feel like every company I have should use something like this, and there's other tools out there as well. I'll tell you mine's the best, my investment's best, but there's others that I'm sure are very good. But keeping that anonymous non-anonymous feedback going and creating a culture is critical, because then people can express, these things. You can nip them in the bud. But there is a major culture issue in Silicon Valley, Wall Street, Hollywood, where people think you should date at work. I think that people have to err on the side of just that is just not something you do, even if it gets very personal. And there are laws around this that I've asked people recently, what are the laws around, can you stop your employees from dating each other? And you can't, but they have to disclose it, and you can't have a superior kind of position to them and do it. But it does happen. We all know people who have fallen in love at work.
Yeah.
It does happen. And then you have to be clear about it. But the problem is, I think there's a class of people, of men specifically, who think that they can use this as a dating pool. And the Slack room is the dating pool. And my message to them is, you guys are losers. There's Tinder, there's Match. If you want to date, swipe
someone
right.
Is 0.1 yards away.
Like, literally, you don't date people at work. Anybody who takes their serious career seriously should not do this. And if it does happen that you work with somebody, I remember the days of the magazines closing. And you would be working 18 hours a day trying to close a magazine, basically put it to bed and send it to the printer. Yeah, people would go out, they'd drink, all kinds of things happened in New York at that time. And then it always wound up blowing up. Every time I had people date in my company, it always blew up. No good came out of it. I'm a big advocate of people not doing that. And I don't think that's all of Uber's problems and issues. But I do think the number one issue is it's been hard charging. It's been a fighter's mentality. It's had to have been a fighter's mentality. And I think people evolve. And, I was very difficult. I was very tough on Zuckerberg when they switched the privacy stuff. You can assume I've been tough on people in my portfolio who have had mistakes like this. And I've had very serious discussions with them about, hey, this is a huge opportunity. And this is not the way to behave. And this is the way a company needs to be run. Nobody's perfect, but we have to evolve here. But I don't like the idea of publicly doing it the way Mitch and Freda did here, or which Sokka did. I told Chris this. I said, Chris, why are you writing a very long blog post about everything that is wrong with Twitter when you're a major shareholder? Like, this does not make the CEO's job easier.
No, and he left pretty soon after that. That was Dick Costlo, right?
Yeah, I don't agree with that kind of activism. There is an active investor kind of thing, but with these private companies and you have young founders, and you could count them on two hands. The number of founders who've grown a company from zero to 10,000 employees. Zuck, Larry Sergey, Steve Jobs, Larry Ellison, Bill Gates. Who else has built, a $50 billion, $100 billion company in this short a period of time? It's very rare. Those individuals, what got them started is not what gets them in that second half of their career. They have to evolve. They have to learn new skills. And that's what I'm trying to do, is be a positive influence on Travis and other people. Just like, let's evolve here. Let's be a better company.
I think you're giving him a little bit of a free pass there, given that he is not a young founder. this is not his first company.
He's 40
years old.
Yeah.
So there's not that it's okay for young people to act badly, but I don't know. I feel like that's saying like, oh, it was 11 years ago when Trump talked about like grabbing a pussy or, you know?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, he was over 50 at the time.
Yeah. I can't disagree with you on that. I do think that there are probably some lessons that should have been learned by now. And there are probably, you know, and I just, people are complex and not perfect. And it puts you in a very unique situation. If you're willing to own, to back the person in the early days, like Mitch and Freda did or Chris did with Twitter, I think you have to back the person and work with them to be a better person since you're in that position of influence. I know I'm in a position of influence. I know that when I talk about Uber or Thumbtack or Wealthfront, people take it much differently than when I talk about Airbnb or Google or Facebook. I own shares in one set of companies, I don't in the other. I will talk freely about Facebook. When I talk about Uber or Wealthfront or Thumbtack, I actually talk to the founder and say, hey, this person asked me to, you know, when Brad Stone wants to write his book, Brad's like a friend, he's on the show. He says, hey, can we get lunch? I go have lunch with him. He says, oh, I'm writing a book on Uber. Can we talk about that? I'm like, sure. Let me see if what Uber's position on your book is. He's like, well, we're friends. I'm like, I know we're friends. I am not saying anything to you about Uber, but let's have a lunch now that you've cornered me. It was a great technique on his part. I said, I'm not going to say anything until I clear it with him.
How many chapters do you think he's going to add to the next edition of that book?
I'm sure a lot. You know, the thing that's frustrating for me, I will say, is frustrating and also makes me hopeful is I know Travis. I know he's a good person at heart. And I've seen him evolve over time. And he knows he needs help. He's written those statements. That's like takes a lot of guts, I think, to write that statement. I know people are cynics and they say writing that statement that I'm flawed, I make mistakes, I need help. It's a very hard thing for, I don't know if I've ever seen a CEO come out and say, I need help. That's the last thing they say. And he knows he needs help. And he is sincere about that because I've had this conversation with him. You can be certain that this is not, I know people want to like just say it's a show and I'm just backing up my guy. But I think he truly and is genuine about this. The frustrating part for me is all the problems we've had of late are all self-inflicted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's incredibly frustrating for me. Because that means we could have avoided them. It's like being up, you know, you have this incredible season and you're up 30 points in a basketball game and then you get a technical foul for hanging on the rim or, you know, ejection. Fouling somebody or just be, you know, a technical foul, right? And you're like, mm-hmm. What are we doing here? This is not, if we're going to lose, it should not be because of these reasons. It should be because of competition from Elon Musk or competition from Larry Page or competition from Apple. That's a reason to lose. That's a reason for us to lose market share or to have problems. But this is not the reasons that we should be losing this. And, you know, listen, I hate to talk so much about it, but I know people want my opinion. I feel like I got to be honest to the audience because you guys have been with me for over 700 episodes and you hear me talk about the good. These are bad things that have occurred. I'm not saying they're not. They have to be fixed and I'm working to fix them. I just really don't like the approach of making it about yourself. This is the most I've talked about it. You don't see me talking about it constantly on Twitter. I made my statement 2 hours after Susan's blog post came out. Because I was out with my daughter on a hike, my phone goes crazy, and people are demanding I make a statement. And, you know, certain off-the-rails journalists who are just absolutely out of their minds are demanding that I call for Travis to resign or the board to fire him. It's not going to happen. I believe in Travis. I'm friends with Travis. I'm going to back him to the end of time. He's my friend. I'm going to try to help him. I'm not here throwing somebody on the bus to virtue signal that I'm a better person, that I don't have flaws. I have plenty of flaws myself. And so do the two of you and everybody listening. If we took our five worst moments and put them out there, would any of us look good? I don't believe so. I certainly wouldn't. Liz would look great. Ben, you'd be a disaster.
Oh.
I mean, Ben, I was there for three of the five. I mean, it wasn't pretty.
We need to do number four then.
It wasn't pretty. Anyway, any more questions for me on Uber? Or
I appreciate it. I think it's good for you to speak.
I mean, do I sound at all hypocritical or insincere in any way? I'm just curious how people perceive my position because, I feel like I'm being as candid as I can be.
It's just like anything else. In my opinion, apologies. I It's just the lens in which you're looking through this. Some people want to see the worst, as we already know, and some people want to see the best. And I'm going to like sit and wait at this point now that this has all happened. Who's he going to pick for the number two? How is that number two going to have an impact? How does he or does he not evolve? Like, at this point, you just have to see what happens next in the future to see, like, is it sincere or is it not? And everything else is just conjecture and speculation.
God, I hope Sheryl Sandberg was considered. Please, Sheryl. I know that you got the presidential run wide open in 4 years, but my God, would that be the perfect? Can you imagine if Sheryl went and did what she did at Google, Facebook, and then did it again at Uber? That would be, what a career. That would be just a perfect career.
I don't think she's on that list.
I don't think she needs to
be on
that
would,
list.
I don't know. I think she'd be on the top of the list. I don't think she would take it.
I don't think she's interested. It's, you're both right.
There are some bigger offices that she may be interested in.
I think, she could be president for sure. 100% she's going to run for president in my mind.
Not Mark.
I don't think Mark's going to run for president. I think governor. But I think she's going to run for president.
He's already the dictator of the largest nation state in the world.
No, I know.
It's fun because now you're all conflicted and you get to say things and I don't usually get to talk about Facebook.
Right.
But I have enough context around it that I can say.
1.3 billion.
It's pretty amazing, yeah. What do you think of, speaking of Facebook and fake news, they've made a little bit of progress on the fake news front. They started labeling stories this week, I read.
Mm-hmm. Disputed.
Disputed, they put. Do you think that's their responsibility to mitigate against fake news on the platform?
I think that they could do some more work. I mean, I think that we...
But is it their responsibility?
Yeah.
It is their responsibility. Okay.
For sure.
You agree? Yeah.
Like, the whole fake news thing happened in the beginning. Like, we have to remember that it happened in part because of the amount of fake news that went viral on Facebook during the campaign. And then the conservatives in some kind of amazing, like, I don't know how, turned the fake news label that was applied just to these, like, truly fake stories on Facebook into, like, any kind of news story that didn't fit the narrative as fake news.
That's right. Fake news doesn't actually mean anything anymore.
Yeah, the phrase fake news has been completely destroyed and twisted.
CNN, fake news.
It's
very
really,
fake news, right? What was the modifier?
Bigly.
Really fake news.
They really fake. Like the Trump movement really twisted that phrase around to their efforts when it was originally about stories that were completely fake about Clinton or about Clinton primarily.
Yeah.
So it's just crazy to see the evolution. This happened in like 6 months. And Facebook was a central part of that. And Facebook definitely has responsibility when it has such a large user base. And I do believe they are, like, you've seen the shift with Zuck. He initially wasn't really thinking about it or talking about it too much. Now he's really thought about it and he's had more thoughtful statements and you're seeing more of that technology coming out. And I think they've taken more and more responsibility for that position they have in the world.
I thought it was a pretty boneheaded comment by him that he didn't think that the fake news could ever be effective on Facebook. And I was like, so you've got this advertising juggernaut, which is driving app downloads and commerce and everything around the world. So it's good for every single use case of advertising and marketing and sharing, except for presidential elections. In that case, it could never happen. No. It could never sway a presidential election, but it could sway you to buy shoes. It could certainly sway you to buy movie tickets or download
an
app.
They've developed the world's most effective addiction engine. They know everything about human nature and how to get us to click on things. And like, they got us to click on all these things that made no sense. And now they need to deal with that.
It's going to be fascinating because Inside.com, the startup I work on every day, has 19 newsletters right now and a dozen writers. And they can figure out what the real news is and what the fake news is. And they can have an intelligent discussion about it. We basically will discuss, like, is Al Jazeera, a terrorist organization, right? Like, there's a group of people who believe Al Jazeera is a spokesperson for terrorists and it's part of the Muslim caliphate and whatever, It's like, well, not exactly, but there may be instances where they have very close connections to people who give them information, just like, so you have to, like, explain this very nuanced point. But generally speaking, an intelligent college-educated person who reads can parse this. So Facebook just has to take a stand on like what are editorial standards? I don't know why they can't understand this, like what is fact checking and.
Yeah, I feel like they're kind of, there's something in there that where they're like waiting for the AI to be good enough to do it so they don't have to admit that humans would be involved, but right. The AI is not good enough. Get humans involved.
Yeah, the AI is not going to be good enough for some time either. All right, we have next up on the show, we have the best visuals of the week. This is a new, and this will be our final segment. This is a new, incredible feature here. The best visuals of the week. First up, Airbus unveils the pop-up. I have no idea what this is. Go ahead. Play the Airbus unveils pop-up. And can our guests see this over here or no? Can you guys see
it? A little, yeah.
Okay. She can. I will pretend.
All right, here it is. This is the Airbus pop-up concept. It is...
It's a flying car?
It's a car with wheels, but then the pod separates from the bottom wheels, and a quadcopter picks it up, and it goes flying. It's made of monocue... carbon, and it seems like everybody is investing in this. I know Uber has a program for flying cars. Larry Page has invested in two flying car companies, and it seems like quadcopters may work at some point. How far off do you guys think we are from quadcopters flying us around? This is really some, if you haven't seen this video, it's worth doing a search for Airbus pop-up. Basically...
So far, she had coffee and got in a car.
She got in a glass car. She parked in a parking space. It's pretty cool, actually. Airbus, which is a company that I don't think is ever going to make this, is giving a roadmap to what a startup is going to make eventually, probably backed by Larry Page. But the little pod that is your car comes off of the wheelbase and the battery pack, and it puts a little pod and then drops the pod off at a golf course. It's pretty dope.
What are the power requirements to fly that all the way there?
That's the problem, is the power density is not enough to do this.
So that's one of the biggest issues, period. Like, yeah. Unless you have U-beam style Wi-Fi power everywhere, or you have much more dense, like the power is the biggest issue right now, period. It's the issue with like jetpacks. You can't do them because of the power density.
Okay, if you had to bet on which will come first, the boring company, which is Elon's new company to drill tunnels, that would have cars, ostensibly, but possibly the Hyperloop. The Hyperloop above ground, so the tunnels below ground with Hyperloop or cars in it, so the boring company. Hyperloop One, Shervin's company to build Hyperloop above ground, or you had to bet on Airbus's flying pods, quadcopters. Which one do you think is most likely to change
company.
The world? You like the boring company.
I do, actually, because I don't want to look up and see... the sky swarmed with little quadcopter bugs. Like, I would rather that that transportation be hidden underground.
Okay, I like that answer. So you're boring.
Yes.
You're going boring.
The like joke boring. Doesn't get old.
It doesn't get old. Boring is what we do. Okay, Ben, are you boring? Are you Hyperloop One? Or are you quadcopter?
So
which one's coming first? Which one do you want?
A disclosure, Sherpa and Shervin are investors in Octane AI.
Okay. A little conflict there. No problem.
I bet it's a both. It's the boring company with Hyperloops.
Okay, right. So you're going to go boring with the Hyperloop in it?
Yep.
So you both got the answer correct. Congratulations. I will let you know. It's like the McLaughlin group. Wrong. Correct. Nah, see?
There was no right and wrong answer.
No, there is a right
answer.
You've
been to the future and you've seen it.
I have been there. I will tell you, the tunnels is the right answer. Because, number one, nobody wants air pollution, which is basically you want to be able to look up at the beautiful sky and not see thousands of cars going. We're talking about 100,000 cars flying between here and... the Google headquarters and Facebook headquarters, you know, down in Mountain View, whatever. You think people in Hillsborough and Atherton want to see cars flying everywhere over their houses? No. Number two, does anybody want one of these dropping out of their... The second one of these falls out of the sky, it's over. Now, tunnels, they're elegant and simple. And if you could 10x or 20x the cost, 10x, 20x the efficiency, thus reducing the cost 95%, which my pal Elon knows how to do. That's what he does. He makes things more efficient. Have you
seen
him?
Maybe this is how he can get Trump to give coal miners jobs.
It's not too far-fetched. And I that is an interesting point. He did not back down from being on Trump's committee, mm-hmm. and he seems to have survived it and thrived. Do you think he should have jumped off of that, Liz? Should he have quit?
I don't know. I buy that he wanted to be in there and see what was going on in the room and see if he could contribute to it.
So personally, you're not going to boycott Tesla over it?
No.
You're not going to delete your...
I'm not going to not buy an expensive car.
Are you going to take your Model X off of the pier and just dump it into the bay? No?
I don't have a Model X.
Okay, good. Because I know that there was a group of protesters who were...
I didn't have any issue with Travis being on the on the Trump board. There's multiple ways in which we need to engage with government, whether we like certain policies or not.
All right, that is also the correct answer. All right, I'm going to do one more correct answer. Ben, very good. I'll check that off right now. Ben gets two correct. Very well done. All right, 3D printing company Apis Core builds 400-square-foot house in 24 hours. This is, and they claim it can be used for 175 years. I think that this is, if you want to live in a prison cell, this is the greatest technology ever. I don't know if I want to live in... can you show it so we can see it? This is the Apis Core 400-square-foot house built in 24 hours. It's basically a 3D printer that pours sand.
Sand and cement. I've seen this video.
And it's got a Samsung refrigerator, but essentially it builds with a 3D printer a cement. It is exactly like a 3D printer, and it's building like almost like a mini lattice in the walls to, I guess, reinforce them. This makes sense, I guess, if you were looking to build houses that nobody wanted to live in. But I do think that robots building houses seems like a pretty great idea.
Is the problem that houses can't be built fast enough? Aren't there a lot of other problems?
I guess there would be regulations in cities of where you can put houses.
The printing for this one only cost around $10,000. That was part of the, like... deal of why it's interesting. And yeah, when you're doing like concrete, even if you paint it, it's still concrete. But here's a couple of things. Like, this will be the future at some point. The problem is that you can't customize it yet.
Yeah.
And a home is one of the things that you really, really want to have custom and feel like yours, as it is the thing that you spend the most time in. And so without the...
Well, if anything can deal with that, it's 3D printing, right? You just feed a different design in.
We're just not there yet with that tech, but it will get there. This is a good piece of progress. I certainly don't want this house, but if you had like different ways to like interchange and just create different kinds of rooms based on different selections, and then it could be customized that way, and it could cost 1/8. That could be fantastic. You also need a better material.
Fab homes are going to be the thing that are going to be more interesting, I think. I have an investment in a company.
Blockable. Blockable's great.
Blockable's pretty cool. And they're going to have the unit at the launch festival in April.
What does it do?
They make a prefab home. This is some of the folks from Amazon's retail business, and like, they built spaces for it. So they use robotics to build, basically, you know, like, here it is. Here's the video of it. But, you know, people want to build container parks. Well, nobody wants to live in those metal containers, and they're heavy, and they're ugly, and they're not easy to work with. What they do is they build modular homes that are stackable, and you can combine them, and you can customize them. But they build it in one location, and it's not so wide that you can't put it on a tractor trailer. So if you bought a plot of land in Inverness or, you know, whatever, like Murphy, California, whatever, like, cool little place 2 hours from the city here, you could order one of these. They would drive it there. And you would save, you would get it done in a third of the time of building a home and for half the price.
And it's little. It's like a tiny home.
It would be like a tiny home, except that if you put two of these trailers together with no wall on the inside, you would have a normal size living room. So if you could buy one of them for $30,000, you could buy five of them for $30,000, you could have $30,000 for your little writer's cabin, one room studio, or you could have five of them and have a three bedroom and, you know, have company over. Or the most interesting part is, when you're starting your career and you're at GigaHome and he's not paying you a lot, you can go buy your writer's cabin.
Mm-hmm.
But then when you go work for Karen Swisher, man, she starts paying you those real bucks at Rico, the D conference, and Wall Street Journal money.
You mean Jim paying the big bucks?
Jim Bankoff paying those big bucks. Now he shot the lock off his wallet. He could that, you know, then you can put two more containers on and you can just extend. Okay, and finally, Epic Games demonstrates Project Raven, a system for blending live footage with AR and other effects based on the Unreal Engine, which is the big competitor to Unity. Epic Games is now doing mix reality with the real world. So I see a car with QR codes in it. I don't understand.
For creation of AR experiences.
I don't know. I think this is the AR experience, is this car. Okay, here's the car driving down the road. And now the car can look like whatever you want it to look like, I guess. So when the car drives by, you see a different car. It says here, dressing reduces time required for film, TV, visual effects, enables other experiences such as a car buying, visualizing different options. Oh, I see. So you have this frame of a car. If you're wearing AR glasses, wherever the car drives, it will put whatever car you want on it. So if you were doing an old time movie, you could drive 10 of these cars around and put old cars on it. But if you wanted to do a 70s thriller, you could put, you know, a 70s cars on it. Okay.
I was living in the Castro when they filmed Milk, and they like redid all the storefronts to be
yes.
as they were at that time period. So like the Thai restaurant became a Chinese restaurant, and you know,
genius.
the museum that's now where Harvey Milk's camera store was yeah. the camera store. I think that's right. And it was really cool to
it's
walk around, and it was almost like
piece.
Going to Disneyland or something in real life, which is way cooler than Disneyland.
That's a great film. What a good film. And actually, by the way, a good book. If you want to read a good
oh,
book,
yeah.
Harvey Milk's, I think it's his biography, his autobiography. I think he wrote it. I read it 20 years ago. It's very powerful, awesome book. All right, listen, this has been an amazing program. What have we learned? What have we learned? The Boring Company is going to be Elon Musk's greatest triumph. He'll get us to Mars, and the only thing people are going to care about is the fact that now you can have a picnic on the 405. Just
Mars
think
is a good place for modular houses.
Here's the thing. I think if he was able to figure out how to do that technology, and literally you could reclaim all the highways or cut them in half and reclaim some of them, can you imagine what that would do for society? Like all these highways everywhere.
It's like the world becomes the High Line in New York, right? It's like
for sure.
you get to use this
exactly.
old space and turn it. Yeah, that'd be cool.
What would the like 405 freeway and the Sepulveda Pass be like? You'd be like, ride your bike through it or something and make it into a huge park? It'd be unbelievable. All right, so we've learned that. We've learned Sheryl Sandberg's going to be the new COO of Uber. We didn't learn that. Just kidding.
In
God almighty.
Dreams.
Yeah. Oh, God, that would be so amazing. Please, Sheryl, please consider it. It'd be so great. She's so amazing.
Wish hard enough.
Exactly. There's a lot. Maybe Meg Whitman would be good, too. I would like to see that. Maybe Meg Whitman or...
I've heard David Sachs and Marissa's names come up as well.
No, Marissa, please. That is the opposite of an operational yeah. person.
Yeah.
I think she's... did a terrible job operating Yahoo. That would be horrific. And she's not a good communicator.
Yep.
But that's Kara Swisher's fault. Marissa was a totally happy person who completely would talk to everybody. She'd be out of defense. And Kara Swisher just so relentlessly beat her up for so many years that she just...
You're looking at me like I'm Kara Swisher's keeper. You know that.
No, like, no one is.
Please
Kara
comment on this, Kara. It's true, though. I mean, can you imagine, like, you were... Can you imagine you're Marissa and, like... You're in a meeting with your people, and then one of the stories was like the people left the meeting with her, and like two of them or three of them went to the parking lot, and like Kara Swisher gets a call from one of them, then her phone line is like, oh, hold on a second, I gotta take this other call. Like she could like literally conference in the people in real time who were in the meeting previously with.
This sounds like Sean Spicer's life.
It is. Spicer's like spicy. Snapchat is in trouble. But I don't believe so. I think they're gonna do okay. Twitter's a disaster. Trump is a disaster. The only thing that's not a disaster. Bitcoin is now worth more than gold. If you own Bitcoin, I suggest you sell now because it's gonna crash again. Buy it on the bump. All right. Hey, thanks Emmy Award-winning producer Jackie. Thanks to Wistia and IBM and everybody on my team for doing a great job. And thanks to our guests. We'll see you all next time. Bye bye.